topic of evangelism and its relationship to evangelism. So before we get started, we're going to pray and just pray a blessing over the word. Heavenly Father, we love you tonight, God. What an awesome privilege it is to be in your house. Again, we thank you for a chance to open your word. But we just ask that your word would come alive inside of us, change us in our walks and our relationships with you, draw us closer to you. So as we look tonight, as Pastor kind of mentioned and came through, we're going to begin to look kind of deeper at each spiritual gift and how it relates. So the first one we want to look at, because it's often a misunderstood gift, because oftentimes we look at the gift of evangelism, and sometimes the gift of evangelism is taken, and we often want to pawn that gift off only on the evangelist. And it's that gift that we say, okay, so they have the gift of evangelism, it's not my job. So we're going to look at the gift of evangelism and how evangelism relates to the gift of, but also how it relates to each individual in relationship to the church and how it works inside the church. So there are two groups of people in every church responsible for reaching people. Number one, Christians with the gift of evangelism. That's the first group of people responsible for evangelizing the world. It is those individuals that have that gift of evangelism. So the evangelist, that individual who has been called to reach and to hold evangelistic meetings, that's the first individual. That individual that has a specific calling to be an evangelist. That individual who will preach a gospel message, that individual who will stand on a street corner, that individual who doesn't mind going into a stadium, that doesn't mind going into a park, that doesn't mind going into a crowded area and preaching the gospel. That's the individual, first individual. But also, it's the Christians without the gift of evangelism. So that includes, encompasses, every Christian in the church. So there's two groups. There's those with that gift and those without the gift. So if we look at evangelism as a whole, every individual in the church is called to be an evangelist. Maybe not the gift of evangelism, but each of us are called to be an evangelist, have some type of evangelistic slant in our lives. So as we look at this, I want to look at the church as a whole, and how does a church reach individuals for Christ? So in a study done, it states this: what influences people to come to church? So it says this for advertisement. So we look at every year as we budget, as we look at churches, and as we watch television, you'll see churches advertising. You drive down the road, you see billboards advertising churches. We, as a church, we hand out cards, we hand out pamphlets, we have web pages, we have apps, we have all of these things. So, advertising. It says that only 2% of people come to church because of advertising. 2%. So if you think about the big generality, we look at America, it says that only 2% people that come to church are influenced by advertising. So as much effort, and we put a lot of effort into advertisement, and I love all of those things, we put a lot of effort in those, but only 2% of the people that walk through the doors of Atlantic Beach Assembly of God will ever come to Atlantic Beach Assembly of God because of advertising, because of our logo, because of our webpage, because of our app, because of the signs that we do, or because of if we do radio ads, because if we do a billboard, all of those things. Only 2% will come to church. There's countless studies that have been done. Also, when we do organized visitation, now, this is one of those things that have kind of gone in the history books of churches. If you remember, there was these big pushes. Baptist churches used to be really big on this, and Sister Rhonda shakes her head because she grew up Baptist. I grew up Baptist. Tuesday nights were always visitation night. You met at the church at 6:30, and if there was cars in the parking lot, you got your list, and you went to the individual's house, and you targeted neighborhoods. Jehovah's Witness churches are huge on this because they believe in a visitation ministry. They believe you go door to door, you hand out pamphlets, you visit neighborhoods. But it says that only 6%, and this is an evangelistic churches, come to church because of the visitation ministry. Does that mean it's ineffective? Does that mean that we totally toss it out the door? No, because we're still reaching 6%. So in other words, we still may reach some individuals through a visitation ministry. So it's not ineffective totally, but it's not the main focus of our church. So organized visitation, only 6%. The next one is pastoral contact, me and pastor going out and visiting individuals. Only 6% come to the church through that. So if me and pastor get out there and we knock on doors and we do our visits, which we do, and we do all of those things, it says that only 6% of the people that come to our church or any church are going to come because they were visited by a pastor. For the most part, when they see the pastor coming, I can tell you they usually want to hide and lock the door. So you were probably doing that when you come to your house. But and then this is a staggering statistic. And this is a statistic that we should really hone in on. It says that 86% of all people that come to church, all people that give their life to the Lord, come by invitation by a friend or family. So the most powerful weapon that the church has is our members. It's you. And those are the members that sit in the pew. It's built upon relationship. So how do we reach the world for Jesus Christ? It's by individuals inviting other people. It's by you building relationships, inviting those individuals at your workplace, inviting those people that you eat dinner with, inviting those individuals that you build a rapport with. So if we're going to reach the world that Christ has called us to reach, we've got to build that relationship. If you think about the earthly ministry of Jesus, think about his ministry. His ministry was built around relationship. His disciples, when he met with his disciples, it was about relationship. He ate with them, he dined with them, he lived with them. It was all about relationship. If we're going to change the world that we live in, we've got to change our approach to reaching people. We've got to stop relying on all of the things that we do and begin to build those relationships. So we are called to be witnesses. We know from Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. We love to quote that verse because we love that first part. But you will receive power. As Pentecostals, we love to quote that part. When the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my, and here's the first part, witnesses in Jerusalem, and all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So it says, look, you receive that power, but it's for the purpose of becoming witnesses in all of those areas. So it says that, look, although you're going to receive that power, our job is to become evangelistic in those areas. God has given us this gift of evangelism, or God has given some the gift of evangelism. So some studies say, and you know, it's just studies, maybe not always 100% accurate, that about 10% of all the churches called to be evangelists has that specific gift of evangelism. Remember, just the gift of evangelism. But all have been called to be witnesses. So what is the difference? The difference is this. Gifted are to make opportunities. So if you're gifted, if your gift is evangelism, you have to make the opportunity to evangelize. In other words, let's look at the greatest evangelist. Billy Graham, he sets up an opportunity to be the evangelist. He sets up a crusade so that he can reach the masses of people. They just don't come to him. He sets up the crusade. He builds an atmosphere. He can present the gospel in a powerful way. That's setting up the opportunity. That's what a person with a gift of evangelism does. A person, a regular Christian that doesn't have the gift of evangelism, are given opportunities by God. So in other words, we have to make the most of the opportunities that Jesus gives us. In other words, when Jesus puts a person in your life, you have to make an opportunity to share the gospel with that person. We don't shove it down their throat, but we have to make an opportunity to share the gospel with them. So the bottom line is this: every Christian should evangelize in one way or another. Proverbs 11:30, one of my favorite scriptures. The fruit of righteousness is a tree of life, and he who wins souls is wise. God has endowed some with the gift of evangelism. God has not called everyone to be part of the visitation program. So in other words, if we one day decide to start up a visitation program, I don't expect 100%. visitation program. Balance needs to be taught when it comes to evangelism. So we have to understand and we have to teach. We can't guilt people into going out and being street evangelists. We can't make the whole church go out and be street evangelists. We have to teach balance and show them how to do this. And we have to understand fear is an excuse. What do you mean by that, Pastor? Fear is a legitimate thing, but also we can't use fear as our reason for not evangelizing. For so many times, we use that as our shield, as our security blanket, and we hide behind that as our crutch, and we never do anything because we say we're afraid. Fear is, and we have to use the word, it's nothing but an excuse. So we have to get past that, and how do we get through fear? Fear is overcome through a couple of things. Number one is fear is overcome through faith. But also fear is overcome through education. What do you mean by that? So in other words, fear has to become through us as individuals. How do we share our testimony? How do we share the gospel? How do we invite people to church? How do we do those things? And we present those opportunities and, you know, we give it as a church. We make those cards to help make it easier to invite individuals to church. We show how to open up those conversations and say, hey, you know, I won't just invite you into church. And we educate, but we also practice. And for some of you, it's the easiest thing in the world to invite someone to church. You just kind of open up that door and you invite them right on to church. But for some, it's not that you're ashamed of the gospel. It's just you're naturally shy, and it's just hard to open up a conversation. So we have to learn to educate, and we have to practice. But every Christian has to discipline themselves to do evangelism. And there's a word in there. We have to discipline, and that's the word of the blank. Discipline. And a lot of us don't like that word. Even as a child, we didn't like that word. And as we move through adulthood, we like that word less and less. It has to become an intentional thing in your life. And we'll talk about that later, but how do you discipline yourself each day and make it purposeful, make it intentional in your life that I'm going to evangelize, I'm going to reach somebody for Jesus before the end of this month. I'm going to reach somebody for Jesus before the end of this month. And you have to discipline yourself and say, this is my target. I'm going after this person. And you go after that person with vigor, and you pray for that person, and you look for those opportunities. So you have to discipline. But you also, and you have to take advantage of opportunities. When the opportunity is there, you have to seize the moment. Not allow opportunities to continue to pass you by. When God opens the door, when that conversation opens, use it. When that person is going through a bad moment, use that opportunity to share your testimony. When that person is sharing about a family situation, use that opportunity to share what Jesus can do in their life. When that person's having a financial need, share Jesus. When that person is having a moment that you know that God can help them, share it. Those are opportunities. When they're having a bad day and they're down in the dumps, share how the joy of the Lord helps you through those situations. Or when the boss is ripping and roaring through everybody and everybody's down and mad and just troubled, you have the joy of the Lord. That's your testimony. Share, take advantages of those moments. Ephesians 5:15-16 says, be very careful then how you live, not as the unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. This next section is going to be individuals that could care less what happens in churches. They don't have an interest in church. They don't have an interest in God. They don't have an interest in the things of God. And when you talk to them about church, they just kind of shrug it off because they have no interest. So there's two groups of people, and there's got to be two different ways that we reach those people. And we have to understand, if we're going to reach those people, how we approach those individuals. For the seekers, it's going to be a little easier because we can begin to have those spiritual conversations. And we can kind of be upfront and honest and kind of in their face about the gospel. But for the non-seeker, we've got to be a little more careful on how we approach that individual. And that non-seeker, we've got to have that more relationship approach where we look for opportunities to share the gospel, where we look and we begin to build a trust relationship. We begin to say, okay, so we begin to look and say, when they're having a bad day, we begin to show them how Christ is living in us, and we are able to share our testimony about what God's doing in our life. And we're a little, not that we're ashamed, not that we hide anything, but we're not so apt to just preach it. So we have to have a different type of relationship with them. So on your list, I want you just to, real fast, look at the individuals in that right column. You just wrote your names in the left column. So in that right column, I want you to put an S beside their name if they're a seeker, meaning that you know that they're looking for a church. You know that they're looking for a relationship with God. Or an N, they could care less about their relationship. So you'll know. Depressed. I don't want to make it. serve as. It serves as the point of us. It serves as our rallying cry that, hey, as a church, we've got to take it up. We've got to begin to become evangelists. We've got to all step in and begin to do our parts. And even whatever generation we're in, we're not done. We're just beginning to work. If you're in that over 65 group, you still got work to do. There's still some of your generation not reached. You still got 35% of your generation that's not been reached. Go after them. We still got a lot of our generation to reach, so we need to get to work. So what are some things that we can do? How do we reach these generations? Number one is that relationships will be key. It's not programs. It's not getting out there and holding things. Relationships. We've got to begin to build relationships. We've got to establish relationships. Mentors. That's picking up or looking at family members and taking them out and doing these type of things and building relationships. It is stated that and I think this is an interesting statistic, when a person has 7 friends in a church, they will never leave the church. When they have 7 friends in a church, and when I read that statistic, I began to think about people in our church, and then I began to kind of do a whip. So I began to look at a person, and I said, okay, they talk to this person, they talk to this person, they talk to this person, this person. Building relationships. You need an existing. If you're going to be someone who helps reach people, if you're going to build a relationship with individuals in the church, you need an existing relationship between you and an unchurched person. You need to build a relationship with an unchurched person. You must have a relationship with Christ also. You've got to have a powerful relationship with Christ if you're going to lead somebody to the Lord. So you've got to check yourselves. You need relationships with members of the church. You cannot just have relationships outside of the church. And I know I'm kind of those individuals that have these type of things. But you've got to have relationships inside the church. You've got to begin to remove barriers. So the next thing is that we have to have events that help knock down barriers. Events that help these relationships knock down barriers. So what are some of the relationship barriers or events that we build? So the first one is what we call a social events, picnics, cookouts, Super Bowl Sunday night. These is the type of events that we love. Those are the events that everybody loves to do because they eat, they just have fun. You hate to say this, there's really not a spiritual aspect about it. We don't break out the Bible, we don't bring up scripture, we don't preach at these type of events. This is that type of event that the only thing that we're there to do is to build hearing, receptive, redemptive, and trusting relationships. It's only to build relationships. It's only to say that, hey, we can have fun, we have friendships, we can build those relationships. So in order to make the event work, though, the only way that we can make these events work for the church, the only way that we can make Super Bowl Sunday night really work for the church purpose of that event is so that we can reach unsaved loved ones. For example, the purpose of Monday Night Football games a few years back when you've done those was to reach unsaved loved ones. And Brother Randall Rodriguez is an example of that particular event doing its purpose. That's the reason he's in church. He came to the Lord during a Monday Night Football. Why? Because it was this type of event. An event just to build relationship. So the reason that we have Sunday night or have Super Bowl Sunday night is so that we can make an event that allows us to invite unsaved loved ones. But at these events, we have to be sensitive to what we do. These events are not designed to push the gospel, but it's a step towards the an opportunity to present the gospel. So we have to, and here's another thing we have to be careful of. We have to mingle with the newcomers. Because a lot of times what we do as a church event is that we like to hang out with the church people. The visitor kind of sits over in the corner and they're kind of pushed off, and all the church people over here, because we know these people. We've got to be careful that we always mingle with those individuals also. And we have to be patient with those individuals, to be patient with those events. In other words, sometimes we come out of that event and we have, and I've heard this, we'll have 20 people show up at an event, and then one or two of them come to the church and they say, well, that really wasn't a successful event because we're not packing food in the center. I don't think that's always true. Because those type of events take time to build that relationship with the community. And it may take that person 5 or 6 times coming over and over to an event before we actually get them inside of the community. Before they actually begin to trust us. Before they actually begin to say, hey, they're not just trying to get me into church to get my money. And a lot of times that's what they're doing. But they begin to see that they can trust us, and they begin to see, hey, and what happens is they come to an event 2 or 3 times, crisis hits their life, and they come back and say, hey, we need something. And we're able to be that arm of love and support and compassion. And then we're able to step into there's this AME type of relationship. And then also there's what we call an RSA event, relationship strengthening activities. They are designed for cultivating, strengthening, and building trust and relationships. These activities take place in smaller events or groups. These events involve key areas, relationship building moments, and spiritual moments. So our men's Bible study, our real life groups, our Tuesday morning women's Bible study, these are the groups that we kind of dig into Scripture. Pray and they become really spiritual moments. To make these events work is that we're not on the edge of your seat all evening looking for the perfect place for a spiritual conversation. And here's another thing. We have to stay away from, careful here, we have to stay away from terrestrial conversations. We don't talk about movies. We don't talk about, here's the topic item. We don't talk about politics in these conversations. We stay away from things that could cause. Why? Because we're not in that moment to really push our agenda. We're just there to have conversations about Scripture, about the Bible, about those type of things. We're not condemning their activities at this moment. These are just small activities that we can learn to build a relationship, learn to have a spiritual environment, and build those things. In order to build relationships, we must, and we're going to close with this particular thing, and I think we have time. So our last point tonight, in order to build relationships, we must have trust. So let's talk about trust just for a moment. Number one is trust is not denial. We must be honest with one another. Stop trying to be something you're not. If there's anything they're going to see, if we're going to build relationships among Christians, they're going to see if you're fake. They're going to see if you're just playing the church game and not playing the outside. So stop trying to be something you're not. Number two is that trust needs boundaries. We cannot be nosy. In other words, we cannot always try to meddle and put our nose in their business. We should not ask a lot of personal questions in the early stages of a relationship. We can ask, is there something we can pray about? We can ask them, are you going through anything? But we can't ask a lot of personal questions. I'm not going to go into what kind of questions you shouldn't ask and what you should ask. But think about it. What are the questions that would make you uncomfortable if a stranger came up and asked you about? trust is not easily gained, and once broken, it is hard to keep. Let me put it this way. New pastor in the Christian life, one of the things that they've done is they have restructured the church a few years before we had gotten here and built a large small group. They built a small group ministry throughout the week. Had several small groups running, and at one point the small group ministry was successful and looked as if it was going to turn that church around and begin to do something for that church. In the process of that, they begin to share with one another, and the trust in those relationships begin to build, and individuals felt that it was a safe environment to share with those leaders what was happening in their lives. One of the individuals in one of those groups shared a very personal issue with me. That issue was later taken to the Roman News and broadcast throughout the church. It crushed that individual. In essence, what it done was it took every one of those small groups, not only busted the trust in that one small group, but slowly deteriorated every small group in that church. So in essence, every small group in that church fell apart. And the pastor that individual had was it took me, years of putting back some trust in that church that I had. Those individuals that have the gift tonight, God, I just pray that they build their gift.